Good morning and welcome to worship with Trinity United Church. My name is Jenny Hess, and this year I will be entering my fourth year of university at Nipissing. Once again, I'll be learning from home. As many of us get ready for back to school, I want to wish everyone a happy fall, and I look forward to hearing about everyone's adventures.
Happy September. I recognize that many of us come into this weekend with mixed emotions and with a variety of expectations. I also recognize that the last 18 months have been such a struggle. And I pray that this community that is so good at reaching out will continue to reach out to one another over the next few weeks as people are in a time of transition. Thank you to Jenny for greeting us this morning. She's a wonderful reminder to all of us of the young people from Trinity who are such a vital part of the community. We hold them in prayer as many take new steps on their journeys. As we come into worship this morning, we look to the Christ candle that is lit, a reminder to us of Jesus who is with us and for us. So often, September feels like a new beginning, and we can remember that with God, every day is a new beginning. God sees the potential in each new day, and in each one of us as we live and move in God's world. Let's come to worship God, the God of each new day and of each beginning. Let's come before God with gratitude and with praise. Will you please join me in prayer? God of new beginnings, God of each new day, how wonderful are your works. As we come to worship this morning, we recognize that for many, this weekend marks a time of change. Return to school, return to work, new opportunities, changes to how we have lived for the last 18 months. For others, this is a continuation of their exhaustion as healthcare workers and essential workers rally through. We each come to this Labor Day weekend needing the assurance that we are not alone. Remind us, O God, that you are with us every day. And as we come into worship, help us to bring the entirety of who we are before you, that your word and your presence might touch us deep within. Amen. As we prepare to take another step, let's join Avery in song.
Keep me traveling.
Hi friends, welcome to worship. I wondered if you might stand up this morning while you're listening to the children's story today. And if you would join me, I want you to take a little step. Can you take a little step? Not too hard, right? Now, can you take a big step? Okay. Could you take an even bigger step? Okay, so you know the difference between a little step and a big step and an even bigger step. And that's when we're walking or moving our bodies. But I got thinking about it after hearing the song that Avery sang to us this morning about steps we take. And so sometimes we talk about steps in terms of things we do. So a little step that you might take might be brushing your teeth in the morning. Or a little step might be putting your plate in the sink. That might be a little step. A bigger step might be getting yourself out of bed in the morning without your parents' help. Or a bigger step might be vacuuming at home. And then the really big steps might be maybe you're allowed to stay home for a little bit of time without your parent there. Or a really big step might be maybe it's your job to cook supper. So we have little steps and bigger steps and really big steps. On Tuesday, some of you are taking some pretty big steps. And I know some of you might feel there are little steps going back to school, but for some people, it feels really, really big. You might be in a new class. You might be starting a new school. You might be going to school for the very first time to junior kindergarten. Or you might be meeting a new friend. Or you might be really nervous about what it means to go back to school when you haven't been there in a long time. Or you might have decided that you're learning at home and it's a big step to get everything ready at home for you to do school there again. So on these steps, the little ones, the medium ones, the really big ones, who's with you? Your parents? Sometimes your grandparents? Maybe your friends all take these steps with you? But you know who is also always with you? God. God is with you on every step you take, the little bitty tiny ones and the huge, huge ones. And when we're excited or when we're nervous or when we're scared or when we're happy, God is right there with us. And God knows all those feelings we have. And if we have big feelings inside and we need to share them with God, then you might say a prayer, or sometimes I just say, God help, when it's a really big step that I need. Sometimes I say it out loud, and sometimes I say it just quietly inside to remind me that God is with me on every step that I take. And God is with you on every step that you take. And so this morning, I think it'd be helpful if we said a prayer for you, for all our people who are going back to school. The ones beginning at JK and the ones heading off to college and university, because they're taking big steps too. And a prayer for parents and grandparents who this is a big step for them, sending their kids off to school. So let's say a prayer together this morning, and you can repeat after me. Dear God, you are with us on every step, the little steps, and the big steps. You are always with us. Be with us on Tuesday
so we know we're not alone. Be with our parents and grandparents and adults, so they know they're not alone. Help us to experience joy every day. And remind us that you are walking with us. Amen. You might want to go back and listen to that hymn that Avery sang for us. One more step along the world I go. It's a great one to remember that God is always with us. Friends, I'm going to keep you in prayer, and I'll look forward to hearing how your back to school week went. Take care. Bye-bye.
This week's readings is from Colossians 3, verses 12 to 17. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you are called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. May God bless this word.
I can't help but wonder how many of you are suddenly surprised that the calendar now says September. And I don't just mean the calendar that you have on your fridge or the one that pops up on your phone. I'm also referring to that internal calendar that keeps track of hours and days and years, of passing phases and new adventures beginning. That calendar that for the last 18 months since the pandemic began seems to be so out of sync with the routines that we once found familiar or comforting. And now it is September, and suddenly that calendar seems to be kicking in, with some being so ready and others dreading what Tuesday might mean. For most of us, throughout our lives, Labor Day weekend comes around, and there's a sense that we're beginning again. A new grade, a new job, a new routine, or a new place to live. September seems to mark a time of transition for many of us. And we see that in full force if you have tried to go to any store or grocery store or bank in the last week. People are out getting prepared for the September transition, stocking up on groceries for back-to-school lunches, buying backpacks and pencil crayons to start the year off right, opening new bank accounts and credit cards for students heading off to college or university, picking up fall flowers and plants to keep the splendor of the garden alive, fresh corn and vegetables from roadside stands, and of course, clothes. I don't know if there's any more popular time to shop for new clothes than prior to Labor Day. Uniforms, sports clothes and spirit wear, the perfect first day of school outfit, and the required at least one pair of unripped pants, sweaters in anticipation of cooler nights, and closed-toe shoes after the luxury of summer sandals and bare feet. New clothing seems to be as much a part of September as back to school is. And it doesn't matter if you shop at the finest of boutiques or love to explore consignment shops and new-to-you clothing. Getting a new outfit seems to be an important part of the whole getting ready for September routine. And let's face it, we all have our own thoughts about clothing. Mark Twain was known to have said that clothes make the person. Naked people have little or no influence on society. Well, for the last 18 months, many of us have gotten used to wearing stretchable pants or only dressing from the top up to accommodate whatever Zoom meeting we might have that day. I've heard many lament that they don't know what clothes they have that fit them anymore, or can't remember that the last time that they went shopping for clothes. A trip to the closet these days can seem like an almost forgotten adventure. And in many ways, also a luxury. As I was setting aside clothes for a friend who takes clothing and supplies to South Sudan a couple times each year, I realized what a blessing it is to be able to figure out what to wear, and how many in our world don't get that choice or even have what they need in order to keep themselves clothed. Being able to choose our clothing is not a luxury that everyone has, at least not in the traditional sense of clothing ourselves. Our scripture reading helps us to think about this in a different way. It's the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Colossians who teaches us how it is that we can clothe ourselves, how it is we can present ourselves and live and move in the world. Paul's wisdom is rooted not in fashion, but in faithful living. Not in the newest styles, but in looking at new life for individuals, for the Christian community, and for the world. It's not based on what you can afford or what will fit or what will be seen on the camera, but rather it's rooted in who you are and whose you are. And in the reading that Jenny shared with us this morning, the Apostle Paul begins by reminding us about who we are. Paul names us, names you and me, not by the name on our birth certificate or that our friends call us, not what we answered to as children or how we introduce ourselves today. Paul names us with our identity as found in God. He refers to you and me, calling us God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. Or as one translation of Scripture says, holy and dearly loved. In a world where many feel invisible, where each day we wonder if anyone really knows who we are, to know that we're God's own, to be assured that God, the creator of the universe, calls us dearly loved, it's what sometimes helps to ground us, to get us through. Paul would have known that, and he wants us to remember our names, to remember who we are and whose we are. So Paul names the people of Colossae, and he names you and me. And once we are named, then Paul helps us to know how we can show up in the world. Paul teaches us, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Above all, he says, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. The clothing in which Paul imagines followers of Christ is not distinguished by the sandals they wear or the cloak across their back. It's not about the most durable labels or the most forgiving fabric. It is instead marked by the character that is visible and that claims them as they interact with one another and within the world. Paul encourages us to think about what it is that we clothe ourselves in each day. And the harsh reality is that the clothing that Paul calls us to wear, the qualities that he calls us to put on, are not always the ones that we most readily turn to. All too often, we witness those who wear the clothes of negativity, wrapping themselves in the latest horror story or scandal. We recognize in ourselves and others the garments of exclusion, superiority, apathy, fatigue, anger and envy and indifference can become as familiar to us as an old pair of comfortable slippers. Sometimes we wear these characteristics so routinely that we no longer even notice that they dictate our wardrobe or that that is how people have come to recognize us. The apostle sees that. He sees it in the people of Colossae, and I would guess that if he were here, he might see it in us too. And Paul knows how destructive that wardrobe can be to individuals, within families, and within the community. So Paul decides that it's time for a makeover. For the early followers and for today's followers to think about what it is that we clothe ourselves in and what it is that we show to the world. And there's something quite impactful about waking up each morning and deciding what it is that we will put on. When you think about picking out a favorite outfit that helps you to relax, or a power suit that gives you confidence, or the necklace that reminds you of the gentleness of your mother. I remember the year that my son Isaac had lucky socks that he wore to every one of his wrestling matches. I should also mention that part of their luck was that he refused to wash them before the end of the season. Well, he'd come to believe that when he wore those socks, things were really going to turn out right for him. And whether the socks really had anything to do with it or not, putting them on each match day helped him to feel prepared for what was ahead and helped him to know who he was in that moment. And I can't help but wonder if the same might not also be true of the clothes that the Apostle Paul exhorts us to wear, that they too will help us to know who we are in the moment, who we are in our lives. Compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, patience, love. We are called to choose to clothe ourselves in characteristics that begin healthy relationships, that lead to unity, that inspire inclusivity and wholeness, that reflect a life lived in Christ. Imagine what might happen on the days when you wake up in the morning and intentionally feel yourself putting on the garment of compassion. Who might you touch? Who might you see with new eyes? How might your relationships be different if prior to having it out with your spouse, you excused yourself and went and put on the garment of patience and humility? What if kindness was the clothing people noticed most about you because each day you wear it with conviction and intention? Last week, I helped to celebrate the life of a family friend who died this past year. I feel very confident in saying that in her 96 years on this earth, she got dressed each morning in compassion, in humility, in generosity of spirit and grace. And all who knew her could describe that wardrobe in clarity and with gratitude. Every day she put on Christ. Holy and beloved, every day is a new day where we get to choose the garments that we put on, that we wear for God. Every day when we remember that God calls us holy and beloved, we can choose to dress in response to that name, to wrap ourselves in the garments of compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, patience, love. Every day, our wardrobe can be a reflection of God's love lived out through us. God's chosen people, holy and beloved. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's continue to worship in song. Let's come before God in prayer. God of cooler evenings and sun-filled days, God of ripening harvests and meals shared around a fire, God of each day, You are with us throughout all of our days, and we come to you now in prayer, opening our hearts and our minds to you. Creator, the goodness of your creation also reveals that there is much groaning and places where your healing touch is so needed. We pray for those who are faced with the harsh and destructive reality of forest fires and flooding and tropical storms. We pray for cities and countries where political unrest is leading to violence. And we pray for the country of Afghanistan, that world leaders might find ways to help resolve what feels to be so drastically horrific. Let prophetic voices be heard, O God. God, as the calendar has changed, we lift our prayers for all those who will be returning to school on Tuesday. Educators and staff, students of all ages, lunchroom supervisors and bus drivers and care providers. We pray for parents who feel uncertain about what this school year will bring, and for all those who carry concerns in their hearts. And we pray especially for our young people. This transition means so many different things for each of them. And we pray that you might calm their hearts, that they might be blessed with finding and being a new friend, that they might feel COVID safe in their settings, and that they might be free to simply be this year without so many of the stresses of the last several months. May your spirit move in them, O God. Healing One, there are many who we entrust to your care as they begin treatment, as they heal at home, as they are in hospital, as they wrestle with changes. May they turn to you and know that you are always with them. God of us all, hear the silent prayers of our hearts. And together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, I don't know what clothes you have on right now, but I know that so many of you clothe yourselves in Christ. Go into this new time of year and be intentional about how you clothe yourselves, knowing that God is always with you and you are not alone. Go in peace, go in hope, go always with God. Amen.
Peace of Christ be with you, and also with you. May the peace Thank you.